Hello and welcome to Guided by Grace. Our relationship to our neighbor is bound up in our relationship to God. This and many other truths help us make up the principles of Catholic social teaching, the body of doctrine developed by the Catholic Church on matters of social justice involving issues of poverty and wealth, economic, social organization, and the role of the state. Oh, this is such an all-encompassing, important topic. As Catholics, what is our role? First, there are seven themes, right? Seven or nine?
What are some of the themes? Depends on the translation that you're using. And it's important to realize that the Catholic social teachings really started with the encyclical Rerum Novarum in 1891. So they're not new. They've been around, and it's a matter of how we adjust them to the times. But the essential seven themes are, the first one is called the dignity and the right to a life of the human person. Called a family, community, and participation, and rights and responsibilities are the first three.
The following is the option for the poor and vulnerable, which is putting the needs of the poor and vulnerable first. The dignity of the rights of workers, which is the economy must serve the people, not the people serve the economy. Solidarity, we are all one human family regardless of our ethnicity. And care for God's creation, which is we are stewards of the earth.
It's nice to have all those categories, but what does that really mean about how do we live our lives? What do we do to help people?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think we were chatting about this before, that, you know, it's often these teachings, Catholic social teachings, are often referred to as the best kept secret of the Catholic Church, often mentioned in, you know, universities or classrooms where it's taught. And reason being is because I think there could be a perception of the church that, you know, we're not engaged, or that, you know, the times have passed as to, you know, it's not relevant anymore. But these teachings show exactly how relevant the church has been from the beginning, and it still is. And they're classic teachings, you know, and they're universal. They don't age, or they don't age out. They stand to each time, you know, in each place. So
I think it's so important that more people are aware of the Catholic social teachings. They're not, like you were saying, strictly for Catholics, or for everybody. If we can get the essence of the life and dignity of the human person, that encompasses so much of what we talk about here on the show. And, you know, it looks at the poor and the vulnerable in our society. How do we show the dignity for each human person? And poor and vulnerable is not just economically poor.
No.
And I think that's a misconception that happens so often. I mean, there's so many different ranges of poor. You could be
Let's define. What are the different types of being poor?
We could certainly be socially poor. You know, in the school setting, sometimes you see a student who might be a loner, not by choice. So how do we have other students reach out to that particular person? You can be spiritually poor. You know, those who are lacking that connection with God. How can you reach out to that person who's spiritually poor? You know, I'm sure in the medical field there's plenty.
Yeah, you can have mental health challenges for somebody who's not able to assimilate in society for whatever reason. They certainly need the community and society to sustain them and to help them. I think we could look at areas where, you know, somebody might be physically disabled, and in that way there we could see that there might be. There are great needs, and we are called to take care of those that we call most vulnerable, those who are on the margins, and then those who are economically poor, of course. I mean, when we talked about what our role and missions are as Catholic, it's our responsibility, and we're called to action. And that's really, you know, who we are. We can't separate out, you know, care for one area and not the other. As we talked about on another show, it's interrelated. So we have to approach the approach the issue with all of that in mind.
Right. I always want to be asking the question, are we doing enough? But we can never do enough.
Well, I still have a great sense of pride, though. You know, the fact that the church has given this gift to us, it's, I have a great sense of pride that it's logically laid out. It's very clear. And if somebody calls upon me, I can say, well, look, here it is.
That's
you know, oh, your church isn't doing enough. We can always do more. And I think Pope Francis has called us to that call in Joy of the Gospel and the recent encyclical, Laudato Si. But it's there, and the fact that it's there is better than it's not being there. You know, so it's that constant reminder to us.
Yeah, and I think we also have to realize that while there might be some organizations that exist at a given place and time to help a situation, they need to be sustained. Mm-hmm. So we have to keep renewing that. So if there's an organization in our community that is helping in some way, like we have in our community something called Hi Hi, mm-hmm. which is a program that helps the homeless, mm-hmm. you know, that's sustained by maybe people who at that moment in time can give their mm-hmm. help, but maybe in a month or two that might not be able to continue. So I think if we look closely in our communities, we can find programs that are really good, but they're going to need help to stick around as well.
Definitely.
It's all about being part of the community, like you said. You know, call to family, community, and participation mm-hmm. is the Catholic social teaching.
Yeah.
It's not a coincidence that Jesus was a community kind of guy.
Right.
You know, he had friends. He was, you know, yes, he had time to retreat and be alone. Mm. But you have, first of all, we have the Trinity. We're a social
Absolutely. In
religion.
Yes,
we're in communion with mm-hmm. other, and we need to be aware of that so that when other organizations are trying to help people, we participate in that any way that right. we can.
And our salvation is linked to one another.
Exactly.
No one is, you know, your salvation is not just you and God, and it's just you and the prayer, and that's it. It's through one another mm-hmm. that salvation is, you know, made realized.
Yeah.
You know.
Right. We want to take a look at a video right now. We, of course, will continue this discussion. But we are saltandlight.org is a project of the United States Conference of Catholic Bishops aimed to create communities that strive to share God's love with others as we encounter Jesus Christ through the Holy Spirit's transforming presence. Let's take a look at their mission and learn how our faith inspires us to respond as disciples in the world today.
When we encounter Christ in the Eucharist, we are transformed in love as members of a community. We are sent as disciples to encounter Christ in the world, to pray together, to reach out together, to learn together, to act together. Transforming our world, our communities, and each other in Christ. We are communities of salt and light. We are salt and light.
And so what exactly is the organization We Are Salt and Light?
I think it's an initiative out of the United States Conference of Catholic Bishops that really tries to get underneath all that we're talking about and to try to put into local communities the idea of their responsibilities for this mission. Mm-hmm. And one area that they highlighted that I know we didn't touch on yet was prayer as a community.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
We've talked about church and mass, mm-hmm. but as you said, salvation doesn't come as, you know, as just you and God.
Right.
It comes through others. Right. So I think prayer as a community mm-hmm. is very, very beneficial
right.
for the individual praying and then for the community together.
Right.
I think a lot, McGee, when you will ask us, are we doing enough? Mm-hmm. Sometimes people think they can't do enough because of they're too busy or they're older or whatever, they're too young, whatever it might be. You could always pray.
Mm-hmm.
So when you think you're not doing enough, you could always take that time and pray for those who are doing things or for those
right.
who need the prayers to get through whatever they're going through.
Mm-hmm.
I know the sisters in my community that are elderly, that's their ministry now.
Yes.
They have completely active ministries, in my opinion, because they pray daily
mm-hmm.
for people who are going, you know,
right.
trying to live the Catholic mm-hmm. social teachings.
And Mother Teresa said, I maybe, you know, slightly misparaphrased, but she said something about, you know, if we have no peace, we have forgotten that we belong to each other.
Mm-hmm.
So if we belong to each other, these are the things that we have a responsibility to do for one another.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, as I said, salvation through, now it's important to say that it's through Jesus Christ, but
but
we, you know, we're called to bring one another together. We have a mm-hmm. responsibility to share the good news and to care for one another. So it's not alone.
Right.
Yeah.
And I think we're going to continue this discussion. We just have to take a break right now. But when we return, we'll chat with one woman whose organization is rooted in the principles of Catholic social teaching. They strive to serve all who come to their doors for aid, not because they're Catholic, but because their organization is. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Guided by Grace. Joining us to continue our conversation today on Catholic social teaching and the wonderful work being done at her company is Laura Cassell, the CEO of Catholic Charities of Rockville Center, one of the largest human services agencies in the region. Welcome, Laura. Thank you for being here. When we talk about Catholic Charities, we all have different ideas of what their main mission is. What is your main mission?
Sure. I like to describe Catholic Charities as the social service arm of the Diocese of Rockville Center. And our mission is really threefold, and it kind of corresponds to some of what I think you were talking about already. The first is service, and that's the thing that most people associate with Catholic Charities, the direct services that we provide through our ministries. And we have a wide range of ministries, and that's where there's a lot of confusion because different Catholic Charities and different dioceses have different programs that they operate, so it's not uniform. But I can go into more detail on that later. So services, second is advocacy. So the importance of pairing up, responding to people in need with speaking out with and on their behalf to work toward a more just society, to really try to deal with some of the unjust circumstances that often give rise to why they turn to Catholic Charities in the first place. Mm-hmm. And then the third, and often overlooked, is the element of convening, which is really bringing together the community so that we are all united in this mission of the church. We can't really think of it, you know, even though I describe us as Catholic Charities of the Diocese and the institutional response to people in need, that doesn't really absolve each one of us as individuals of faith from really participating in this mission of the church.
And, you know, something that I've always been curious about, approximately how many parishes do Catholic Charities serve? Because it is such a big organization, just approximately.
Right, so in our diocese, there are 133 parishes, and I would say at least 115 of them have some sort of formal outreach or social ministry effort in place. But I also would say, whether it's formalized or not, all Catholic parishes are outreach offices. Yes. It is just natural that when people are up against any kind of struggle in their lives, that the church is a very natural place to turn in their time of need. And so when you say, you know, what parishes or how many do we serve, we actually consider ourselves to be in partnership with all the parishes of the diocese, because many times they're already dealing with people who present themselves at the parish level with different kinds of needs, and they can often respond to that in full without any involvement or support from Catholic Charities. But there are also many times and many cases where the circumstances are so complex and they need more professional support, which may correspond to some of the programs and ministries of charities.
Yeah. Thank you.
Sure.
Yeah. What are some of the programs and ministries? What service do you do?
Yeah. So this is where if you meet up with different people and you ask them, many times people know one slice of what Catholic Charities is all about because they know someone who has helped through that particular program, or they themselves had to turn to that program. Very few people know the whole of it. You know, most people say Catholic Charities, they're there and they do nice things for people, you know. So Catholic Charities here in the Diocese of Rockville Center has quite a wide scope of ministries. We work with people who have mental illness, people with addictions, and of course, all of these things affect whole families. Sure. We work with veterans, we work with immigrants, we work with senior citizens. We have food programs, we have affordable housing. Many people don't know that the Diocese of Rockville Center is actually one of the largest providers of affordable housing for senior citizens here on Long Island. Yeah. So there are an awful lot of programs. We have residential programs, we have clinical programs. And also, we are very conscious that all of what we do is done through the lens of parish social ministry. So that's that partnership with parish that I was talking about. And you know, I like to talk about Pope Benedict's first encyclical, mm-hmm. Deus Caritas Est, mm-hmm. which was so affirming of all of us who've devoted ourselves mm-hmm. to this work of the church. Mm-hmm. Because Pope Benedict said, you know, there are three elements to being church, and you need all three. You can't mm-hmm. have two out of three. Mm-hmm. Proclaiming the word, celebrating the sacraments, and living a life of charity. Mm-hmm. And so we need to do that institutionally as church, and we need to do that individually as people of faith.
So how does Catholic social teaching relate to the work of Catholic Charities? Because I know our office works with Regina residents and women who continue their pregnancy and have no place to live can turn to Regina residents and they can stay there through their pregnancy and shortly after as well.
I'm so glad you raised that because I didn't mention it earlier. But I would say that Catholic social teaching is really foundational for all that we do, not just as Catholic Charities, but for being the Catholic Church. Mm-hmm. And there are certainly the whole notion that life is sacred and mm-hmm. each individual person has dignity. That really gives rise to why we as a church are there for people in their time of need. And I want to really point out that a lot of people think that Catholic Charities serves only Catholics, but the reality is Catholic Charities responds to anyone in need who turns to us, and we like to say that we respond not because they're Catholic, but because we are. Mm-hmm. So the themes, I really say, you know, all the wonderful themes of Catholic social teaching, whether you're using the 7 or the 10 or 9, or there's mm-hmm. so many different lists, but I think they're so thoughtfully developed. Right. And they really are a guide to us so that when we're there responding to a person, we are doing that as church. Mm-hmm. And so what that means, regardless of what area of ministry, is to say that in that encounter, it is an encounter with Jesus. Mm-hmm. It is Matthew 25. When did I see you hungry or thirsty mm-hmm. or a stranger and I welcomed you? And so it is in the disposition of the individual who is responding, and we take that very, very seriously.
So if people watching are interested in either getting involved in using your services mm-hmm. or volunteering, how do they get in touch? And sure. how do they find out what is available?
Sure. Well, our website, www.catholiccharities.cc, not org. Certainly all of our ministries and a lot of details about our programs and where we're located is right on our website. But they can also call us. Our main administrative offices are located in Hicksville. So the general number there is 516-733-7000. And we're always looking for people who want to become engaged because mm-hmm. it gets back to that community,
right?
Right. We are one community. None of us exists in a vacuum, just mm-hmm. me and my God. Mm-hmm. You know, our God wants us to be in communion with one another. Mm-hmm. And none of us can live in this world alone. Mm-hmm. And so we mm-hmm. want to invite everyone to participate in Catholic Charities. Catholic Charities is not just there for the people who need our programs. We're there for the whole church. All that we do in the name of everyone in the church. Mm-hmm. Every believer. We are all disciples together in this mission.
This might be an obvious question. Why did you get into this work? It sounds like it's the core, your yes. fundamental you. I mean, but how did you start?
I do feel so blessed to be involved with Catholic Charities. I didn't plan when I was young to necessarily work for the church. I'm actually a product of public school. A lot of people just assume I went to Catholic school. My first Catholic school was college. And so it's been a very interesting journey, but the thing I know for sure is that the hand of God has guided me every step of the way. And while my life is very, very different than I planned or imagined, it is precisely what it is supposed to be. And I really do feel it is such a privilege mm-hmm. to have any role in this mission of the church and to have a role in mobilizing the great team that we have at Catholic Charities, staff, volunteer, board members, and all our partners throughout the diocese.
Well, you're very inspirational to hear you talk. Yes. Thank you so much, Laura Cassell, for being with us. CatholicCharities.cc, right?
Yes.
One word. You want to find out more. You're always looking for volunteers.
Always looking
You're always looking for donations,
absolutely.
Probably. We all need donations for Catholic Charities. Thank you so much for being with us.
Delighted.
We have to take a quick break, but Guided by Grace will return right after this. Hello and welcome back to Guided by Grace. For further reading on today's topic, we have selected the book Living Justice, Catholic Social Teaching in Action by Father Thomas Massaro. And Sister Megan, you know a little bit about this book. You teach, you use a workbook in your classes.
I do. It's not quite as thorough as this particular book, but this book is very good because it will show you the Catholic social teachings listed, and then next to it in a chart, it tells you all the encyclicals and letters from the popes and other documents that coincide with it. So if you want to get into what the authentic writings are, you can get to that. It also has reflection questions. It's used as a student workbook, I would imagine, for a higher level. I loved teaching the Catholic social teachings. It was a passion of mine because it's something that we can look at today's society. You can read a newspaper, watch the news, look at comics, and everything's going against the Catholic, not everything. Oftentimes there's something going against the Catholic social teachings, and we could read the article and say, okay, how can we change this to support the rights of workers? Mm-hmm. You look at, regardless of what your job is, you're doing something to continue creation that God has given us, and you're doing your best. So, you know, when I was a waitress, sometimes people would look at you like you were, you know, a servant. I'm like, no, you know, I'm getting my degree in moral theology, but how do you want your eggs?
Yeah.
You know, and it's a matter of what you're doing is good. Mm-hmm. So it's the rights of workers and the dignity of all work. And it's just so important. And I think more conversation needs to be had about all of the Catholic social teachings. And this is a great starting point if you want to learn more about them.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, Laura was speaking with us just before the break, and she mentioned just in between in the break about Pope Francis, how vital this ties in with his just sentiment and call for the church to be a place where we meet people in their suffering. And, you know, she mentioned the quote where he'd rather a church that's really wounded and open rather than closed in on itself. Mm-hmm. Or another image that he used is the image of the field hospital, that, you know, you treat the injuries where you see them. So you treat people suffering where you see it. Now, it doesn't always completely eradicate, because suffering is something that we have to deal with to a certain degree, but you help alleviate and accompany people along the way. And I think with the Year of Mercy coming up, that's something, you know, or that we're, you know, in the midst of, that's something we need to keep in mind.
And suffering gives you strength. I just remember my wonderful nuns at Sacred Heart. They would always remind us that through suffering, you know, as long as you can get through it, and find the strength to get through it, but you do learn something from the suffering.
Yeah.
And something my mother always taught me, and it's so true, the older I get, doing things for other people, back to that, makes your life so much better.
That's right.
If you're thinking, if you're slightly depressed on your own worldview, if things aren't going the way you want them to, hey, think about someone else.
Yes.
Right.
Take the attention right off of yourself. Go do something for someone else, and you're going to feel so much better. Mm-hmm. But you all live that.
We all do.
I would also mention that you know, the Year of Mercy that we're talking about, Pope Francis actually is challenging us not to wait for those who are wounded in any way or poor in any way to come to us, but actually we have to go out and find them and bring that spirit of mercy, or that I think he calls it a balm of healing to those. And I think it's very, very a strong point that we should know and understand the church is at its very best, I think, when it ministers to that person in need.
Definitely.
Whoever church is at the moment, one of us or a group of us, that person that is in crisis in that very moment, I think, is when the church is at its best.
And that's
best.
What being a Catholic is, not to help just a Catholic. To help someone else means that you're being a good Catholic. My definition. Yeah. That is all we have the time for today. Please join us for a prayer for social justice. Let us pray now for the strength to respond to the call for justice in the world and to love deeply in a difficult time in a complex world where injustice is visible in so many places.
May we renew our commitment to respond to this call through our prayers as well as our actions. We pray that we are grounded in love as we look at the world and the challenges it presents.
We pray that we are open to God's grace and touched by the Spirit's wisdom as we reflect on our church's teachings on social and economic justice. We pray that we move beyond fear to speak with compassionate courage and to act with both conviction and humility.
We pray that we hold on to hope and that we embody hope through our actions in private and in public. Make us whole, O Lord, and help us know that our wholeness will endure only through solidarity and engagement for the common good. We pray this in your name, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Now, on behalf of my co-hosts, we thank you for joining our conversation today. God bless you, and we'll see you next time on Guided by Grace.